talked about how this book came to be. You see, Paul was a prisoner in Rome, and he had started the church in Philippi, and you'll recall, perhaps, that while in Philippi, Paul was thrown into jail, and he was mistreated, beaten, and then God freed him through an earthquake, and the Philippian jailer got saved. And they wanted Paul to leave town quietly, and Paul said, no, you can't mistreat me as a Roman citizen and let me just disappear from town. That's not going to work. Paul could have claimed his Roman citizenship much earlier and probably saved himself a beating. But it wasn't what was best for the gospel. So Paul started the church there. He did end up, after encouraging the believers, he went on to other works. And he eventually ended up back in Jerusalem, was arrested in Jerusalem, taken to Rome after appealing his case to Caesar. And here he sits in Rome in chains between two Roman soldiers 24 hours a day. 6-hour shifts, 8 different men to witness to a day. And he says that the gospel was going out. Well, the church at Philippi had heard of his imprisonment and was very worried for him. See, the word had gotten back that Paul was in Rome. So they wanted to do something. And so they sent Epaphroditus, I've got it up here, Epaphroditus, to Rome with money to help Paul, to encourage Paul. However, Epaphroditus decided that that wasn't enough, so he set out to get more money and more help and ended up getting sick nearly to death. And the church in Philippi hears that Epaphroditus got sick. And they got worried again. And so they somehow sent back to Epaphroditus that they had heard about his illness and was worried. And that caused Epaphroditus to be worried. And so Paul writes the letter to Philippians, to the Philippian church, to calm their anxiety. I tell you, my friends, it's easy in today's world to get anxious about what's going on around us. Is it not? It's easy to start worrying about what might be or what's going to happen next. We have heard in the news, it seems like weekly, of another tragedy happening in the United States, isn't it? This week, it's at an elementary school in Northern California. Is God out of control? How should we think about these things? And I tell you, my friends, we need to think like Christ thought. I'm going to skip this one. We need to develop in us the mind of Christ. So we're in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 1. And it says, therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort in love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Paul desires that they fulfill his joy. That's what it says here. And this is a command. This is in the imperative mood. When we talk about scripture and we look at verbs, we want to look at the ones especially that tell us what we are to do. It's the most important parts of scripture are those things that are in the imperative mood. Now, the other things are important, but they support that. Why is Paul saying you need to fulfill my joy? Well, he's saying it because of what the church was already thinking. He says in this first part up here, in verse 1, he's saying, because you desire to comfort me. Why did they send Epaphroditus? Because they wanted to help Paul. They wanted to comfort Paul. They were worried about him. And Paul says, if there's any consolation, any comfort, any encouragement that comes through Christ, this word consolation is the idea of encouragement. You want to encourage me, Church of Philippi? I want you to fulfill my joy. And he's going to explain what that means. Second reason, then there's four of them. First one is because you love me. You see, there's four under this, you love me. If there's any comfort of love, the idea of knowing somebody loves you, I tell you, it's hard for Don and Joyce to be away from Richie this morning. But there are people there that love that young man. One of his best friends, Janae, is there. That brings us comfort, amen, Joyce, Don? Brings me comfort. I'm concerned about it. It's easy to be anxious about what's going on with Richie this morning. We don't know what the end result is necessarily going to be. But there's comfort of love. We know there's people there that love him. We know there's people here that love him, that are praying for him. Fellowship in the Spirit has the idea with that close association because of the Holy Spirit. And then that idea of mercy, compassion. It's hard to hear about somebody like Carmela's cousin's little girl and not be moved with compassion. Carmela's cousin's little girl was out by a campfire, and her dad threw gasoline on the campfire, and it flashed up and burnt her over 70% of her body. How old is she?
12 or 13.
12 or 13 years old. She's in the hospital. She was in an induced coma for quite a while. You think about that. What happens to your heart if you have any soul at all? What happens? Does that make you feel bad? Does that make you have compassion towards this person that is obviously hurting? My wife was cooking down some pork a couple nights ago. And I decided I was going to move the crock pot. Only I forgot that the top edge of the bottom part of this crock pot is hot. And I put both thumbs on it at the same time to push it. And I had a stripe across here and I had a stripe across there and And all I could think of was that little girl. That hurt. I was running it under cold water and it still stung. My thumbs are fine today. You can see a little shiny spot. She's not fine. And it caused me to think about that little girl in a little bit of a different way, because I have never been burnt like that. And I can't imagine. I've been told how painful it is. Paul's saying that if you have this kind of mercy, you love me, then you'll do this. You'll fulfill my joy. How? Well, if you fulfill my joy, you'll have the same kind of thinking. These are the reasons I missed it. He says, fill my joy by being like-minded. The same kind of thinking as me. Remember, what was Paul's thinking while he was at Philippi? He could have, as soon as they started to arrest him and throw him in prison, he could have said, I'm a Roman citizen. But what was more important to him, his own well-being or the gospel? The gospel was more important. He wanted the church to have the same kind of mind, the same kind of thinking that he had and that Christ has. It's more important that the gospel go forward than I be safe and comfortable. He says, I want you to think, be the same kind of thinking, have the same kind of love, have the same kind of attitude. This idea of being of one accord has the idea of our attitude towards each other. And finally, to be of one mind, and this has to do with our goals, has to do with our aspirations. What are we driving for? What is the most important thing in your life? Is the most important thing in your life the acquisition of money? Is the most important thing in your life your kids? Many people would say, yeah, it's my kids. My kids are more important to me than anything else. Is the most important thing in your life your spouse, your wife, or your husband? None of those should be the most important thing in your life. When the lawyer asked Jesus, what's the most important commandment of the 400 plus commandments of the Old Testament? What's the most important? Jesus didn't say, love your family. He didn't say, love your kids. He said, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, mind, and soul. Amen? God is the most important. The furtherance of the gospel is more important than I am. I read stories about pastors in countries that are closed to the gospel, and how there have been many times that they're thrown into work camps because they preach the word of God. To them, the most important thing was the gospel. Paul says we need to have the same kind of mind as he had. What not? This isn't an idea of unity just within ourselves, because if we have just unity within ourselves, we could be thinking wrong. Amen? We have to have unity with something that's bigger than ourselves, with Christ. So he goes on to tell us what that mind should look like. First, four requests. These are all commands in the passage. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition. Never for yourself. Well, now, pastor, you know, we've got to do some things for ourselves. It's not what he says. That little word, nothing, up there means nothing. Not one thing. Not even a little thing. We are taught in this world that you have to take care of number one. You have to do it for me. Do you know what Jesus says? He says, love your neighbor as yourself, after he said, love the Lord your God. He never, ever once commanded you to love yourself. You see, that's something you do automatically. How many of you miss very many meals? You figure out a way to eat, right? Or, you know, Richie may need to have a little bit more sleep, but he still does sleep. The body kind of requires it. We tend to do what's necessary to take care of ourselves. Sometimes we think we're taking care of ourselves when really we're harming ourselves. But, you know, that may come a little later when we get to the dessert table. But we're really pleasing ourselves, aren't we? We like desserts.
Yeah.
I'm glad you guys brought desserts. It's going to be good. Never for ourselves, but in never for ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. It simply means always put others before yourself. Always put I have a Joy Club kid. Right here. He is our senior Joy Club member. And I think he better know what joy stands for.
Jesus, others, you.
Jesus. Why what does that mean?
Jesus
put,
first.
Yeah.
Put Jesus first, others next, and then yourself.
See, it's joy is a order of priorities. Jesus first, others second, and yourself last. Not third. Believe it or not, it's last. We emphasize that because third, maybe there's somebody that's fourth. No, last. You see, always put others, let each of you esteem others better. That idea is more important. Well, your needs need to be more important than mine. If we each did that, can you imagine what kind of church we will have? And I think this church is pretty good at it already, but you know what? We're still full of selfish people. Amen? Anybody believe you're selfish? If you don't, go look in the mirror. I am. Look out for others. Don't just look out for your own interests, but for the interests of others. See, this is the way Paul thought, and he's about to tell us that this is the way Jesus thought. You see, we want to think like Jesus. We want to have a mind that sees the world through the eyes of Jesus Christ. There is plenty of people out there teaching you to look through the eyes of the world. There's plenty of programs on television, there's plenty of classes in school, etc., that teach us how we should think. Had a professor, Al Murdoch, that called it your Weltanschauung. No, you can't translate that. It's a German word. A German word means your world and life view. Your world and life view. The world wants to teach you to look at things through the eyes of selfishness and selfish ambition. However, that's not what Jesus did. So Paul gives this strong command. Let this mind be in you. That was also in Christ Jesus. We must develop in ourselves the mind of Christ. The mind has the idea of the way of thinking. When I stand at Highland Baptist Church in Hayward and I look out over the Bay Area and I see those millions of lights, what goes through your mind? Oh, that's a pretty scene. Oh, it's beautiful. Oh. People need the Lord. That's the way we need to think. Our heart should be tugged at the millions that are dying in their sins. What did Jesus do? What was his way of thinking? How did he think? His nature was that he was God, equal with God. I want to take you to John 1, my favorite verse in the Bible. It is by far my favorite verse. In the beginning was the Word. Whatever it means to have been in the beginning, whatever began, the Word was already there. Name something in your mind that had a beginning. The Word was there already. The world had a beginning. He was already there. You had a beginning. he was already there. In whatever it means to have a beginning, Jesus, the Word, was there. And the Word was with God. In the Greek, it means the Word was face to face with God. And I changed the order. If you look in your English Bibles, it'll say, and the Word was God, right? I changed it. Why did I change it? Because the Greek says, and God was the Word. Whatever it means to be God, the essence of who God is, that's what the Word was and is. Now, interesting thing. I love preaching on this passage. This God right here, the Word was with God. In the English, it has the word the in front of it. The Word was with, in the Greek. The Word was with the God. When you have the in front of God, it means the Father. And the Word, which we know is the Son, was with the Father. And then it says, and Theos, the Greek word for God, God was the Word. So the Son was with the Father, and whatever it meant to be God, that's what the Word was, the Son was, and is. So when we think about Jesus and what he did and how he thought, we have to start with the fact that he was God. That he was the creator of all things. Every time in the Old Testament that the Son of God appeared, I'll give you the example of Gideon. What did Gideon do when the angel of the Lord, which was the Son of God, appeared to him? He fell on his face and worshipped. So we go back. Christ Jesus was in the form of God. He was the essence of who God is. He was of that same essence. And then it says, did not consider it robbery. I'm going to use a different translation. Would that be okay? There it is. Who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be held on to be grasped. You see, he didn't need to hang on to his equality with God. What does that mean? In the Greek, we have the word kenosis. And I'm going to look kenosis. K-E-N-O-S-I-S. K-E-N-O-S-I-S. Kenosis. It means to empty. He emptied himself of something. That's what this whole phrase, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, is one word in the Greek. But they can't be easily translate. He emptied himself. You see, emptied himself, assuming the form of a slave. If Christ had come to the earth in all of his glory, in all of his might, as Almighty God in the flesh, everyone that met him and everyone that saw him would do what? They would fall on their knees, flat on their face, worshiping. They would have no choice because they would be confronted with their Creator. So he emptied himself. He veiled, if you will, covered, if you will, for a short time, his glory, his recognizability, the fact that they could recognize him. See, if he had come in all of his glory, he could not become a servant. And it says that he assumed the form of a slave, becoming man, taking on the likeness of men. See, Christ could not fulfill the cross in his glorified state. So how did Christ think? He thought that you were worth setting aside his glory for 33 and a half years. You were worth it so that he could provide salvation. You were worth the beating. And you were worth the cross. You see, it says he became obedient to the point of death, even the death on a cross. Say, Pastor Tim, this is Thanksgiving. Yeah, it is. And I want you to develop an attitude of thanksgiving for what Christ did, understanding fully that he laid aside his rights as God. We don't always have to claim our rights. We have to think like Christ. Whatever becomes necessary for the furtherance of the gospel, as long as we don't compromise the message. Whatever sacrifices we have to make, we need to be thinking, having the mind of Christ. Now, something's going to happen in the future. You see, Jesus humbled himself. But in the future, God's going to glorify him. God's going to set him up. See, for this reason, God highly exalted him and gave him a name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. They didn't bow when he was on the earth, but they're going to, because what he emptied himself of, the Father is going to reinstate. He gave a peek of it at the Mount of Transfiguration. The Father's going to give it back and glorify him, and everybody that sees him, everybody will see him. And every knee will bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord, is the Master, to the glory of God. What did he empty himself of? This. He emptied himself of the fact that every knee would bow, but that God's going to restore that. See, he couldn't have provided salvation. He couldn't have been on the cross. He couldn't have gone to the cross without that emptying. He did it for us. Not just as an example. He did it to provide us salvation. But now Paul says, that's what we need to be like. That's what we need to think like. That's what we need to develop in ourselves. And we look forward to the day that we will be there to confess Jesus Christ as Lord. Amen? In the meantime, we express our thanksgiving. We express our gratitude for the cross, for the sacrifice that Christ gave us in providing our salvation. Father God, we thank you We thank you that Jesus Christ came to be our sacrifice, to pay our price, to take our penalty of sin upon himself. Father, help us to renew our minds, to develop in us that same way of thinking that was in Christ Jesus. Change us. Because of your Holy Spirit living within us, make us different than when we came into this place. Help us to grow each and every day closer to you and closer to your Son. We'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name. Will you join me in standing?